makes the day that lights the way. That Monday, the 16th of November, 1959, was still another fine specimen of pheasant weather on the high wheat plains of western Kansas, a day gloriously bright-skied, as glittery as mica. Often on such days in years past, Andy Earhart had spent long pheasant-hunting afternoons at River Valley Farm, the home of his good friend Herb Clutter, and often, on these sporting expeditions, he'd been accompanied by three more of Herb's closest friends, Dr. J.E. Dale, a veterinarian, Carl Myers, a dairy owner, and Everett Ogburn, a businessman. Like Earhart, the superintendent of the Kansas State University Agricultural Experiment Station, all were prominent citizens of Garden City. Today this quartet of old hunting companions had once again gathered to make the familiar journey, but in an unfamiliar spirit and armed with odd, non-sportive equipment. Mops and pails, scrubbing brushes, and a hamper heaped with rags and strong detergents. They were wearing their oldest clothes. For, feeling it their duty, a Christian task, these men had volunteered to clean certain of the 14 rooms in the main house at River Valley Farm, rooms in which four members of the Clutter family had been murdered by, as their death certificates declared, a person or persons unknown. Earhart and his partners drove in silence. One of them later remarked, "It just shuts you up, the strangeness of it, going out there where we'd always had such a welcome." On the present occasion, a highway patrolman welcomed them. The patrolman, guardian of a barricade that the authorities had erected at the entrance to the farm, waved them on, and they drove a half mile more down the elm-shaded lane leading to the Clutter house. Alfred Stuckline, the only employee who actually lived on the property, was waiting to admit them. They went first to the furnace room in the basement, where the pyjama-clad Mr. Clutter had been found sprawled atop the cardboard mattress box. Finishing there, they moved on to the playroom, in which Kenyon had been shot to death. The couch, a relic that Kenyon had rescued and mended and that Nancy had slip-covered and piled with mottled pillows, was a blood-splashed ruin. Like the mattress box, it would have to be burned. Gradually, as the cleaning party progressed from the basement to the second-floor bedrooms, where Nancy and her mother had been murdered in their beds, they acquired additional fuel for the impending fire. Blood-soiled bedclothes, mattresses, a bedside rug, a teddy bear doll. Alfred Stuckline, not usually a talkative man, had much to say as he fetched hot water and otherwise assisted in the cleaning up. He wished folks would stop yapping and try to understand why he and his wife, though they lived scarcely 100 yards from the Clutter home, had heard nary a nothing, not the slightest echo of gun thunder, of the violence taking place. Sheriff and all them fellows been out here fingerprinting and scratching around. They got good sense. They understand how it was. How come we didn't hear? For one thing, the wind, a west wind like it was, would carry the sound t'other way. Another thing, there's that big Milo barn between this house and ours. That old barn would soak up a lot of racket before it reached us. And did you ever think of this? Him that done it, he must have knowed we wouldn't hear, else he wouldn't have took the chance, shooting off a shotgun 4 times in the middle of the night. Why, he'd be crazy. Of course, you must say he must be crazy anyhow to go doing what he did, but my opinion, him that done it had figured it out to the final T. He knowed. There's one thing I know too. Me and the missus, we've slept our last night on this place. We're moving to a house alongside the highway. The men worked from noon to dusk. When the time came to burn what they'd collected, they piled it on a pickup truck and, with Stuckline at the wheel, drove deep into the farm's south field, a place flat and full of colour, though a single colour, the shimmering, tawny yellow of November wheat stubble. There they unloaded the truck and made a pyramid of Nancy's pillows, the bedclothes, the mattresses, the playroom couch. Stuckline sprinkled it with kerosene and struck a match. Of those present, none had been closer to the Clutter family than Andy Erhard. Gentle, genially dignified, a scholar with work-calloused hands and sunburned neck, he had been a classmate of Herb's at Kansas State University. "We were friends for 30 years, he said, sometime afterward. And during those decades, Erhard had seen his friend evolve from a poorly paid county agricultural agent into one of the region's most widely known and respected farm ranchers. Everything Herb had, he earned, with the help of God. He was a modest man, but a proud man, as he had a right to be. He raised a fine family. He made something of his life. But that life, and what he'd made of it, how could it happen? Erhard wondered as he watched the bonfire catch. How was it possible that such effort, such plain virtue, could overnight be reduced to this? Smoke, thinning as it rose, and was received by the big, annihilating sky. The Kansas Bureau of Investigation, a statewide organization with headquarters in Topeka, had a staff of 19 experienced detectives scattered through the state. And the services of these men are available whenever a case seems beyond the competence of local authorities. The Bureau's Garden City representative, and the agent responsible for a sizable portion of the western Kansas, is a lean and handsome fourth-generation Kansan of 47 named Alvin Adams Dewey. It was inevitable that Earl Robinson, the sheriff of Finney County, should ask Al Dewey to take charge of the Clutter case. Inevitable and appropriate. For Dewey himself, a former sheriff of Finney County from 1947 to 1955, and prior to that a special agent of the FBI between 1940 and 1945, he'd served in New Orleans, in San Antonio, Denver, Miami, and in San Francisco, he was professionally qualified to cope with even as intricate an affair as the apparently motiveless, all but clueless, Clutter murders. Moreover, his attitude towards the crime made it, as he later said, a personal proposition. He went on to say that he and his wife were real fond of Herb and Bonnie, and saw them every Sunday at church, visited a lot back and forth, adding, "But even if I hadn't known the family and liked them so well, I wouldn't feel any different, because I've seen some bad things, I sure as hell have, but nothing so vicious as this. However long it takes, maybe the rest of my life, I'm going to know what happened in that house, the why and the who." Toward the end, a total of 18 men were assigned to the case, full-time. Among them, three of the KBI's ablest investigators, Special Agents Harold Nye, Roy Church, and Clarence Dunce. With the arrival in Garden City of this trio, Dewey was satisfied that a strong team had been assembled. "Somebody better watch out," he said. The sheriff's office is on the third floor of the Finney County Courthouse, an extraordinary stone and cement building standing in the centre of an otherwise attractive tree-filled square. Nowadays, Garden City, which was once a rather raucous frontier town, is quite subdued. On the whole, the sheriff doesn't do much business, and his office, three sparsely furnished rooms, is ordinarily a quiet place, popular with courthouse idlers. Mrs. Edna Richardson, his hospitable secretary, usually has a pot of coffee going and plenty of time to chew the fat. Or did, until, as she complained, the Clutter thing came along, bringing with it all of these out-of-towners, all this newspaper fuss. The case then commanding headlines as far east as Chicago, as far west as Denver, and indeed lured to Garden City a considerable press corps. On Monday at midday, Dewey held a press conference in the sheriff's office. "I'll talk facts, but not theories," he informed the assembled journalists. "Now, the big fact here, the thing to remember, is we're not dealing with one murder, but four. And we don't know which of the four was the main target, the primary victim. It could have been Nancy, or Kenyon, or either of the parents. Some people say, well, it must have been Mr. Clutter because his throat was cut. He was the most abused. But that's theory, not fact. It would help if we knew in what order the family died. But the coroner can't tell us that. He only knows the murders happened sometime between 11 p.m. on Saturday and 2 a.m. on Sunday. Then, responding to questions, he said, no, neither of the women had been sexually molested, and no, as far as was presently known, nothing had been stolen from the house. And yes, he did think it a queer coincidence that Mr. Clutter should have taken out a $40,000 life insurance policy with double indemnity within 8 hours of his death. However, Dew was pretty darn sure that no connection existed between his purchase and the crime. How could there be one, when the only persons who benefited financially were Mr. Clutter's two surviving children, the elder daughters, Mrs. Donald Jarchov and Miss Beverly Clutter? And yes, he told the reporters, he did have an opinion on whether the murders were the work of one man or two, but he preferred not to disclose it. Actually, at this time, on this subject, Dewey was undecided. He still entertained a pair of opinions, or to use his word, concepts, and in reconstructing the crime had developed both a single killer concept and a double killer concept. In the former, the murderer was thought to be a friend of the family, or at any rate a man with more than casual knowledge of the house and its inhabitants, someone who knew that the doors were seldom locked, that Mr. Clutter slept alone in the master bedroom on the ground floor, that Mrs. Clutter and the children occupied separate bedrooms on the second floor. This person, so Dewey imagined, approached the house on foot, probably around midnight. The windows were dark, the Clutters asleep, and as for Teddy, the farm's watchdog, well, Teddy was famously gun-shy. He would have cringed at the sight of the intruder's weapon, whimpered and crept away. On entering the house, the killer first disposed of the telephone installations, one in Mr. Clutter's office, the other in the kitchen. And then, after cutting the wires, he went to Mr. Clutter's bedroom and awakened him. Mr. Clutter, at the mercy of the gun-bearing visitor, was forced to obey instructions, forced to accompany him to the second floor, where they aroused the rest of the family. Then, with cord and adhesive tape supplied by the killer, Mr. Clutter bound and gagged his wife, bound his daughter, who inexplicably had not been gagged, and roped them to their beds. Next, father and son were escorted to the basement, and there Mr. Clutter was made to tape Kenyon and tie him to the playroom couch. Then Mr. Clutter was taken into the furnace room, hit on the head, gagged and trussed. Now free to do as he pleased, the murderer killed them one by one, each time carefully collecting the discharged shell. When he had finished, he turned out all the lights and left. It might have happened that way. It was just possible. But Dewey had doubts. If Herb had thought his family was in danger, mortal danger, he wouldn't have fought like a tiger. And Herb was no ninny, a strong guy in top condition. Kenyon, too, big as his dad, bigger, big-shouldered boy. It's hard to see how one man, armed or not, could have handled the two of them. Moreover, there was reason to suppose that all four had been bound by the same person. In all four instances, the same type of knot, a half-hitch, was used. Dewey, and the majority of his colleagues as well, favoured the second hypothesis, which in many essentials followed the first, the important difference being that the killer was not alone, but had an accomplice, who had helped subdue the family, tape and tie them. Still, as a theory, this too had its faults. Dewey, for example, found it difficult to understand how two individuals could reach the same degree of rage, the kind of psychopathic rage it took to commit such a crime. He went on to explain, assuming the murderer was someone known to the family, a member of this community, assuming that he was an ordinary man, ordinary except that he had a quirk, an insane grudge against the Clutters, or one of the Clutters, where did he find a partner, someone crazy enough to help him? It doesn't add up, it doesn't make sense. But then come right down to it, nothing does. After the news conference, Dewey retired to his office, a room that the sheriff had temporarily lent him. It contained a desk and two straight chairs. The desk was littered with what Dewey hoped would someday constitute courtroom exhibits. The adhesive tape and the yards of cord removed from the victims and now sealed in plastic sacks. As clues, neither item seemed very promising, for both were common brand products obtainable anywhere in the United States. and photographs taken at the scene of the crime by a police photographer. 20 blown up, glossy print pictures of Mr. Clutter's shattered skull, his son's demolished face, Nancy's bound hands, her mother's death-dulled, still-staring eyes, and so on. In days to come, Dewey was to spend many hours examining these photographs, hoping that he might suddenly see something, that a meaningful detail would declare itself. Like those puzzles, the ones that ask, "How many animals can you find in this picture?" In a way, "That's what I'm trying to do," he said. "Find the hidden animals. I feel they must be there, if only I could see them." As a matter of fact, one of the photographs, a close-up of Mr. Clutter and the mattress box upon which he lay, had already provided a valuable surprise. Footprints. The dusty trackings of shoes with diamond-patterned soles. The prints, not noticeable to the naked eye, registered on film. Indeed, the delineating glare of a flashbulb had revealed their presence with superb exactness. These prints, together with another footmark found on the same cardboard cover, the bold and bloody impression of a cat's paw half-sole, were the only serious clues the investigators could claim. Not that they were claiming them. Dewey and his team had decided to keep secret the existence of this evidence.